Penguin Random House Audio presents The Constant Rabbit by Jasper Fforde. Read for you by Andrew Wincott.
Speed Librarying. Somebody once said that the library is actually the dominant life form on the planet. Humans simply exist as the reproductive means to achieve more libraries. "Still on the Westerns, Baroness Thatcher?" I asked, moving slowly down the line of volunteers who were standing at readiness outside our library, a smallish mock Tudor building in the middle of much hemlock, itself more or less in the middle of the county of Hereford, which in turn was pretty much in the middle of the UK. Much hemlock was, in pretty much every meaning of the word, middling. "Westerns are the best when they're not really Westerns at all," said Baroness Thatcher. "Like when more akin to the Greek epics, True Grit, for example." "Shane is more my kind of thing," said Stanley Baldwin, who I think fancied himself as a softly spoken man of understated power and influence. Winston Churchill opined they were both wrong, and that the Oxbow incident was far better with its generally positive themes of extrajudicial violence. Neville Chamberlain tried to keep the peace and find some middle ground on the issue, while David Lloyd George simply sat there in quiet repose, mentally preparing for the adrenaline-fueled 6 minutes of speed librarying that lay before us. Perhaps I should explain. The UKARP government's much-vaunted Rural Library Strategic Group Vision Action Group had kept libraries open as per their election manifesto, but reduced the librarian staffing levels in Herefordshire to a single, solitary example, working on greatly reduced hours, which meant that each of the county's 12 libraries could be open for precisely 6 minutes every 2 weeks. And this is where my hand-picked team of faux politicians entered the picture. Using a mixture of careful planning, swiftness of foot, a robust understanding of the Dewey Decimal Book Categorization System, and with strict adherence to procedure, we could facilitate a fortnight's worth of returns, loans, reserves, and extensions in the 360 seconds available to us. It was known to all and sundry as a Buch Blitz. My name is Peter Knox, but for the next 6 minutes, I'll be your John Major. "Ready, Stanley?" I asked Mr. Baldwin, who oversaw returns and reservations, but was actually retired Wing Commander Slocum, a former RAF officer who famously lost an ear while ejecting out of a Hawker Hunter over Aden. Remarkably, a solitary ear was retrieved from the wreckage of the aircraft and reattached. Even more remarkably, it wasn't his. "Three times ready, team leader." "Mr. Major?" asked Mrs. Griswold, who usually ran the Much Hemlock Village shop, post office, gossip exchange, and pub combined. "I can't remember if I'm Winston Churchill or David Lloyd George." "You're David Lloyd George," I said. "You select the books from the shelves to be given to Mr. Chamberlain, who takes them to the counter, and to Mrs. Thatcher, who offers them up to the sole librarian to be stamped. It's really very simple." "Right," said Mrs. Griswold. "David Lloyd George. Got it." I had devised an emergency code system for speed librarying, and Mrs. Griswold was definitely a code 320, someone who village diplomacy dictated should be on the Blitzer team, but was nonetheless useless. Sadly, no one but myself knew what a 320 was, as the system hadn't reached the levels of awareness I thought it deserved. A state of affairs that had its own code, a 512, lack of enthusiasm over correct procedures. The church clock signalled 10:45. And the chatter gave way to an expectant hush. We had seen the sole librarian rummaging around prior to the opening, and while she would permit us to reshelf, log reservations, and even use the card index, her stamps were sacrosanct, hers and hers alone. Because of this, it was Mrs. Thatcher's responsibility to ensure that books and library cards were placed before the sole librarian, so that her stamping time was most effectively spent. The steady rhythm of rubber on paper was the litmus test of an efficient blitz. Speed librarying was also fast becoming a spectator sport. No TV rights offers yet, sadly, but there was usually a group of local onlookers at every blitz eager to offer us moral support and ensure that tea and seed cake and a rub down with a towel would be forthcoming once the blitz was over. Not all onlookers were so helpful. Norman and Victor Mallet were the de facto elders of the village and dominated every committee from parish council to steeple fund to coordinating Much Hemlock's entry in the all-Herefordshire spick-and-span village awards. They were not themselves huge fans of libraries, regarding them as just one more pointless drain on the nation's resources. They had turned up ostensibly to support the current Neville Chamberlain, who happened also to be Victor Mallet's wife, to complain bitterly about anything that contravened their narrow worldview, and for Norman to take possession of his reserved copy of The Glory and Triumph of the British Colonial System Illustrated. At 2 minutes to opening, Mr. Churchill, in charge of extensions, audiobooks, and swapping tired periodicals for slightly less tired periodicals, indicated she needed a toilet break and would be unlikely to return within 15 minutes. This was unfortunate, but not a fatal blow, as Mr. Beaton, a long-standing friend and next-door neighbour, was my all-paths understudy. "Can you do Churchill?" I asked. "We shall never surrender," said Mr. Beaton with a grin, before coughing a deep, rattly cough. "Are you sure?" said Stanley Baldwin to me in a low voice. "He doesn't look very well to me." "Mr. Beaton is the picture of good health," I said in a hopeful manner, with little basis in reality. Mr. Beaton had so many ailments that he was less of an elderly resident and more of a walking medical conundrum, the only two ailments which he had not suffered in his long life being tennis elbow and death. So Mr. Beaton, now Winston Churchill, dutifully took his place behind a wheelbarrow containing 46 neatly stacked books, all carefully sorted by shelf order for ease of return. I nodded to David Lloyd George to acknowledge the last-minute change in the team, and she nodded in return as we saw the sole librarian approach the front door of the library and then check her watch to make sure she didn't open a second too early. This was, in fact, crucial. There were two Herefordshire Library opening times compliance officers in attendance, armed with clipboards and stopwatches, the pair funded at great expense by the Rural Library Strategic Group Vision Action Group, which now employed just under 4,000 people, coincidentally the exact same number as the librarians whose continued employment had been deemed incompatible with UCARP's manifesto pledge. I checked my watch. "Little hand says it's time to rock and roll." The sole librarian threw the lock and the door swung open. We moved in with military-style precision, Winston Churchill pushing before him the wheelbarrow of books to be returned while Maggie Thatcher started the stopwatch. "Good morning," I said to the sole librarian.
"Good morning, Mr. Major," she returned in a sing-song tone. "Will we hit our target today?"
"As easy as negotiating Maastricht," I replied, trying to exude confidence, when secretly I felt we would manage returns and loans but fall short of our renewal and reserves target. The team swiftly moved to their allotted places. Mr. Churchill, Mrs. Thatcher, and Stanley Baldwin went straight to the front desk and presented the books to the sole librarian. Within a few seconds, a steady thump, thump, thump filled the air, demonstrating that work was very much in progress. At the same time, David Lloyd George and Neville Chamberlain went rapidly down the aisles, transferring the pre-ordered picks to a trolley ready to be brought to the front desk,
once the returns, extensions, and reservations were completed. And once that was done, Mr. Baldwin could reshelve the returned books, assisted by Neville Chamberlain. "Time check," I called. 90 seconds gone, Mr. Major," replied.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.